Thank you, and good afternoon or good evening, everybody. I just want to say that, you know, God works in mysterious ways. And I just look at this as, you know, a new ETA strength. I could not have done this alone. And as a matter of fact, I stopped writing for about 6 months after I realized I had to give a lot of myself. It hurt me because I had to go inside myself to places I wanted to forget. We all have skeletons in our closet that we really like to keep buried and don't like to deal with. But in order for me to write this book, I had to go there, and I had it buried. So what I did one day, I stopped writing for 6 months, and just as I was about ready to go on vacation in Greece, I emailed Mom, and he told me, he said, wash the sheet in Greece. Gave me a little joke. And I was sitting on the beach, and I sat down, and before I started to write again, I just said a little prayer. You know, I just said, hey, you know, I can't do this alone, Lord, and can you help me, you know, get this off? Well, after that, you know, it came, things started coming a little easy. I was able to look inside myself and put it on paper. But, you know, I just want to thank Angela because, you know, like, wow, without her, she took everything I had inside, and that's why I say a blessing, you know. I mean, I tell a story about a man in the woods. A man was lost. God for some help, and you know, our engine came, and after when he told the story to his boys, he said, yeah, I just got to help, and some angel came and helped me, you know, and like, you know, I look at the signs in life, you know, and Angela was a sign for me, because she didn't touch on, try to make anything I did look fabulous. She just took the spiritual side of me and made sure that that was the basis, you know, the basis of the book, that you saw that I just wasn't cold-hearted, that I did believe in God, but I was like anybody else. I went astray, you know? And Mark, after I read White Boy, I decided, because I hadn't heard anybody tell the story about what really happened growing up in the 50s in the Bronx. All I hear about is the Bronx is burning, and most of the generations from the 70s on are really afterbirth of the turbulent 60s, the younger generation. You know, and with all the programs and everything that was cut in the city, these kids and everything that are still out here today are the products of what happened in the 70s. No programs, you know, just running loose, nothing. And so after I read White Boy, I decided maybe I should tell my story. Because I couldn't understand how I had been dipped in all kinds of things in my life. And now I'm laying back in Europe, retired. You know, I'm retired, I got a nice apartment, I'm driving a Jaguar, I'm eating good, I'm sitting back there, and I'm wondering, was this it? Is this what I'm supposed to do? So then, you know, after I read the book, I decided to write, and I never met Mom. And you know, anything about street, you know, mostly in my era, blind people, you know, do not believe in delayed gratification. They want this dessert now. You know, and when you don't know somebody, especially from the street, and you know, and said, yeah, well, trust me, let's write a book. You know, but after I read White Boy, I knew that Mark had street cred, and I had one of my boys who worked for CBS, Mike Cemetery, who told me, yeah, check him out. And we both started writing, experimenting. You know, I tried, and I kept going, and the more we kept going, the more we got into it. But then we got to a point where it was just a book. That we had anything I did. Each other, we said, yeah, we got a rock here, but what happens now? And that's where Anthony came in, bless her soul. Because she just took the thing and handled it like a Picasso. You know, she went through it. I tell you, it couldn't have been done without her. I give her props, you know, she's my hero. Because she took everything that we wrote together, Mark and I, and she just made it readable, made it with feeling, emotion, so that you could feel it. The person that read it felt it. Me, you know, he didn't feel that, you know, he felt that axe I did, but he also felt the good I did. He felt how I felt. And I'm just glad that, you know, if one person is helped by this, one kid, then everything was worth it, you know. I feel that I gave back, you know, because I got to, I got a son who's having the same problem with that. This book, I hope will help him. It's a blessing that we all came together like cookbook. It's going to be a cookbook because it's the truth. It's about my life. And it's the truth. And I represent that. It's not something you can see on CNN. We don't need the news. We don't need all the props. You know, all we need is the truth. And when people read it, they feel it, and they realize that it's coming from a good place. You know, it covers the area. It makes more, you know, people can understand that, you know, the Bronx wasn't burning. They were good people. You know, people don't know that in the 1950s, that black people were the minority of Bronx. The minority. They built a settlement house like the Israelis do in Israel, in a settlement, in the middle of a decaying white commerce, and just imported blacks from all over the city, you know, and started to live. So we had everything. All the programs, everything was covered. We had Jewish, we had Italian, we had Irish, we even had Chinese, you know, some Chinese. We had all these people. But it wasn't until the late 60s, the early 60s, 63, when the Harlems came, that blacks, no blacks, white, Jewish, they started to move out because the crime and things started to get bad, you know, and the businesses and everything started to collapse. But there were good people out there. And these people needed, you know, this story needed to be told. You know, they're the unsung heroes. They're the ones that are the doctors, the lawyers out here today. They're the ones that are still in the community centers out here today, making sure these kids, you know, it's emotional because